sort of man one that I got in books. You probably kept a saloon. Interesting, though.
Sleep. I'm so excited. I'm in too deep. Crazy, but it feels alright. Baby, thinking of you keeps me up all night.
sick tickets. sounds out loud to the class. Then please put your notes away, because the next person that I find has the notes in class will have their notes read out loud to the entire class. Okay? Thank you. Now, we are going to be reading. Jimmy McGrath. Castle Select's tour, represented by 7 depressed-looking females and 3 perspiring males, looked on with considerable interest. Evidently, their Mr. Cage had been an old friend. They all admired Mr. Cage so much. His tall, lean figure, his sun-tanned face, the light-hearted manner with which he settled disputes and cajoled them into good temper. This friend of his now, surely rather a peculiar looking man, about the same height as Mr. Cage, but thick-set, and not nearly so good looking. The sort of man one read about in books, who probably kept a saloon. Interesting, though. After all, that was... Kayla, can you put that away, please? After all, that was what one came about, to see all these peculiar things one read about in books. Up to now, they had been rather bored with Bolo Hill. The sun was on downfall hard. The hotel was uncomfortable. There seemed to be nowhere particular to go until the moment I should arrive to motor to the metropolis. Very fortunately, Mr. Cave had suggested picture postcards. There was an excellent supply of picture postcards. Anthony Cade and his friend were stepped a little apart. "What the hell are you doing with this pack of females?" demanded McGrath. "Starting here?" "Not with this little lot," grinned Anthony. "Have you taken a good look at them?" "I have that. Thought maybe you were losing your eyesight." "My eyesight's as good as ever it was. And no, this is a castle full of joy. I'm Castle. The local castle, I mean. What the hell made you take on a job like that?" "A regrettable necessity for cash. I can assure you it doesn't suit my temperament." Jimmy grinned. "Never a hog for regular work, were you?" Anthony ignored this aspersion. "However, something will turn up soon, I expect." He nodded. "It usually does." Jimmy chuckled. "If there's any trouble here, Anthony Cade is sure to be in soon or later. I know that," he said. "You've been absolutely unstable for hours, in the long lives of a cop. When can we have a line together?" Anthony sighed. "I've got to take you, tackling him to see those graves." "Yes, he said, switching a signal. Broken back, bumped black and blue with a wreck in the road, and clamoring for the rest of the green lights. Then, you and I will have a spot or two, and exchange the letters." "Right. So long, Jimmy." Anthony rejoined his flock of sheep. Miss Taylor, the youngest and most skittish of the party, instantly attacked him. "Oh, Mr. Cade, was that an old friend of yours?" "It was, Miss Taylor. One of the friends of my blameless youth." Miss Taylor giggled. "I thought he was such an interesting looking man." "I'll tell him you said so." "Oh, Mr. Cade, how can you be so naughty? The very idea. What was that name you called you?" "Gentleman Joe." "Yes. Is your name Joe?" "I thought you knew it was Anthony, Miss Taylor." "Oh. Go on with you," cried Miss Taylor coquettishly. Anthony had by now grown his business duties. In addition to making the necessary arrangements of travel, they included soothing down irritable old gentlemen in their dignity to uphold, seeing that elderly matrons had ample opportunities to buy picture postcards and flirting with everything under half of 40 years of age. The last task was rendered easier for him by the extreme readiness of the ladies in question to read a tender meaning into his most innocent remarks. Miss Taylor returned to the attack. Why does he call you Jack Bell? Oh, just because it isn't my name. And why Gentleman Joe?
Perfect. It's good.